if it's all right with you, shouldn't we go back to my mother, who was really formative? She had been a playwright. First, she'd been an actress on the road playing Meg in Little Women. She followed Alice Brady as in the first New York production of Little Women. And then she played the part of Meg on the road. And when the play got to St. Louis, she was 30 and getting very, she wanted children. She didn't care about a husband, but she did want children. So that when there's this quite presentable young man who was a bank clerk, but had a crush on theater, joined the company as a supernumerary. She discovered that he played a good game of bridge, and he would go out with her and another couple in another play, also on the road, Henry Hull and his wife. They made up a foursome for bridge, and that led to their marriage. And mother then had a very brief 3-year marriage when I was 3 years and 9 months. And when I was three and my brother was a year and a half, she eloped with us. She snatched us away without telling my father. She kidnapped us, took us to Utah where her family was. She was the daughter of an apostate Mormon, by the way. So I offer you that for what it's worth. The family had apostated so long when she was quite young, so it didn't really clerical politics didn't enter into it. But she knew she wanted to be a writer, and she knew she wanted to spend her life doing it. But she wanted to write plays. So my approach to this whole industry was that movies were just a kind of odd film stage play, and that was as an actress and as a writer initially. As far as I was concerned, movies were just this peculiar variant on the theater, which was important. And I considered movies kind of a vulgar variant. And for some reason, they were very popular, which I thought a shame because stage plays were more important.
So tell me about some of your mom's work.
Well, the main thing she did was when I was about 8, 9, 10, she did a play about her family, which took a prize at the Pasadena Playhouse. It was called Skidding. And she got herself a job in New York as a play broker and tried to market her play while she was criticizing and marketing other people's plays. And she used to bring the plays home for me to read, age 10. So I was, at age 10, much of my reading were the plays that were submitted to her office. And I began to develop, I think I just subconsciously developed a sense of structure, which has stood me in very good stead ever since. Anyway, the play opened in New York with Clara Blandick, and it was panned by every critic in New York except the Brooklyn Eagle. And George G. Nathan, the critic on Judge, says, "If this play plays longer than 2 weeks, I resign my position as judge." And it outran, they papered the house for 3 months because the audience, they could tell the audience loved it once they were there. So the audience grew and grew, and at the end of 3 months, they were no longer papering the house, and it outlasted everything but Abie's Irish Rose. And MGM finally bought it. I don't remember at what point, but I do know that by the time I was in junior high school, she was writing Dance Fools Dance for Metro. She was working for Louis B. Mayer's son-in-law, what's his name? Irving Thalberg. Okay. Anyway, and all my life I was writing. She had me reading everything, and she encouraged all the writing that I would do. My brother, who was a kind of a natural born engineer, was very much left out of the family direction. How did I get into the industry first? I was acting first. She wrote me a play for when I was 17, graduating from high school, called Growing Pains, another amateur. She did very well in the amateur market. You know, every day of the year, some school, someplace, did one of her plays. So that's what raised us. After high school, I was due to go to Stanford. I was accepted. And mother wrote me the play. We did it in Pasadena. We did it in Palo Alto, then in Pasadena, and then it was taken to New York. This was 33. And during the run of a 2-week run of the play, I had been signed by Paramount, which as I say, dropped clean in my lap because I never had any intention of acting in movies at all. I was just interested in the stage. But I also wanted very badly to go to Stanford. My mother had written the lyrics to come join the band and when she was a freshman at Stanford, gotten $25 for the lyrics. It was a contest. And it was considered kind of the family second home. So after the play ran in New York for 2 weeks and folded, 3 weeks, sorry, folded, we came back and I went on up to Stanford to start winter quarter there. And did the things you do at Stanford in those days. You joined a sorority and all that good stuff. And came back down and did some acting for Paramount. They didn't have anything for me initially, and they sent me to the Roosevelt Hotel where Max Reinhardt's advance man was rehearsing Midsummer Night's Dream. Gloria Stewart was supposed to play Hermia, and she hadn't shown up to any rehearsals. So they had me reading Hermia in her place. She never turned up, so it was understood that I would be playing Hermia at the Hollywood Bowl. And there was this nice English girl who was my understudy, who was understudying me and Mickey Rooney, who was playing Puck. And when I was pulled out just before the dress rehearsal of Midsummer Night's Dream and put in a W.C. Fields play at Paramount, movie rather, I remember being so insulted. They cast me as W.C. Fields' daughter in It's a Gift. And my feeling was they took me out of a Shakespeare play to make me act with this drunken vaudevillian. And of course, that's now a classic. Very few people remember Max Reinhardt and his plays, but they can still see W.C. Fields and It's a Gift and be. When I came back from New York, it was the depth of the Depression. It was 37, and I had seen, which I mentioned in the book, I had seen men standing in doorways sheltering against the November weather in New York. It's the first time that I'd ever really seen what poverty looked like. In 1933, coming back from the closing of that play, my mother picked up a young man on the train, Maurice Rapp. She saw him typing, and having no shame, she looked over his shoulder and saw he was typing in the dramatic form and introduced herself as a playwright and learned that his father was a producer in Hollywood. And she brought him back to our car in the almost like this, you know, look what I brought you, like a mother cat with a mouse. And what she didn't know was that Maurice, instead of dating me, started taking me to study groups. So that's how I got first involved in the left. And then within a year or two, I began to get very restless because I knew that if I wanted to be a writer, I had to read other stuff. I could not devote myself to this really quite boring matter of economics, the wage labor and capital and that stuff. So by the time that I did the second play, Mother's second play in New York, I was out of that. Came back and I called my old friend Waldo Salt, whom I had known in high school. He had been on the crew in one of Mother's plays that I had had a bit part in. And he, in fact, had taken me to my first Stanford prom. Waldo, by that time, had become a junior writer at Metro. And his roommate, his office mate, was a lovely young man named Hugo Butler, who was also a junior writer at Metro. And Waldo invited me out for lunch at the studio commissary, and I wanted to find out what had happened to a screen test I'd made with somebody else, and went. And instead, just thought that Hugo was the most enchanting man I had ever met in my life. He was 22, but quite young, you know, kind of young, boyish for his age. And I remember his saying as Sam Marx walked by, some people say that Sam Marx has a mouth like an open Gladstone bag. And oh, I was so impressed. And later on, we had been invited to somebody's house for cocktails. And he telephoned me and said that if he picked me up, it would obviate my having to find my own way there. And I thought that any man who used obviate in casual conversation was the man for me. So anyway, we were engaged by That was November. We were engaged by February and marrying in June of 37. At that time, neither one of us, I was totally removed from the left. I mean, I was simply not interested. I wasn't against it. I just didn't have time for it. Too much else to learn. And Hugo's father had been a writer in film, first an actor, then a writer. He had played silly Englishmen in spat family comedies, and then he had graduated to writing. And he ended up writing a little of everything. Oh, he had played Agnes Aird's brother in Son of the Sheik, by the way. So we really, you know, we really have, and my son is a television writer too, so we really are an industry family. When Hugo was a junior writer and was first getting into the industry, his very conservative father got him to join the Screen Playwrights, which was a real company union designed to keep people away from any of this union business, this nonsense. And Screen Playwrights, you know all about. It was just bitterly reactionary. But in short order, Hugo began to realize it, and so did Waldo. And they both got out, and I, in fact, have a copy of the letter, of Hugo's letter of resignation from the Screen Playwrights. And they joined the Infant Writers Guild, Screenwriters Guild of America. And very soon after, as it was building, during that period, and I think that it was in the late 30s, not long after our marriage, IATSE made a move to try and take it over. And we were having mass meetings in Hollywood to protest the IATSE move. And somewhere along the line, I believe that the Labor Department decreed that there should be a union election. And I can't remember what year that was, but that was the point at which the Writers Guild safely earned the right to represent the writers. And in the meantime, I was doing a little writing, still trying to be a writer, doing a little acting, and Hugo and I had a child, which we lost from a too difficult labor, and just as the war was breaking out. This was a very dramatic period in world history, and I went into labor the morning that Germany marched into Poland, and sat up all that night timing pains and listening to the report of Germany's bombing of the Athenia. And war was on by the time the baby was born. Born in law. She lived about 2 days. Anyway, about a few months after that, I had written a play. I was trying my wings. And while it didn't go on any place, Hugo had graduated from the junior writer department. He had written by this time. He had been taken under the wing of Joe Mankiewicz, who was his mentor, and Dory Sherry, who was his other mentor. And in fact, Dory Sherry had been the best man at our wedding. He said that all through the part in the ceremony about the Holy Ghost, he kept his fingers crossed, because his mother had had a kosher catering establishment in Jersey. Anyway, in 1940, the junior writer department was now looking for a new batch of young writers. Hugo told me to suggested that I submit the play, and I did, and it was immediately, picked up. It was apparently on a much higher professional level than most of the stuff that the young film students were submitting to try to get in. Anyway, so there were about four of us adopted then. Marvin Borowski was one. He was my office mate for a while, as I remember. And somebody named Russell Rouse, who became a writer. While Hugo was busy writing things like The First Christmas Carol and Lassie Come Home, he was building his reputation. Metro was still making, the first time I met Hugo, I asked him what he was working on, and he said he was working on a movie from a play by a Miss Serenia Rouverol, who was my mother. He had been waiting to be asked that. It was really a setup. So Hugo was very busy. We were both trying to get over real heartbreak over the baby, and it may be why we have had so many children since. We have six children, and I think that we just never felt secure. We never felt safe from another accident. Anyway, I enjoyed, but by the time that I was writing, working as a junior writer at Metro, I had gotten myself a radio acting job, which is a good thing to do when you're out to here with a pregnancy, because the camera there isn't a camera there, and as long as you can reach the microphone, it doesn't matter. So I, One Man's Family had been, it was an old family soap opera that had been running for years, with the original cast, and I joined. I married into the family, as it were. I became the girl that married the youngest boy. And I worked on that thing for 13 years, through four other pregnancies, through the first one and then four other pregnancies. And the only time I wept about leaving Hollywood was when I had to tell the people on the family that I had to leave the show. Didn't tell them why, but I guess they all figured out why. In the meantime, Hugo had always wanted, he'd never wanted to be anything but a screenwriter. He wasn't interested in acting. He was interested in the images on the screen as a way of telling story. I mean, I think he could have written Silence and done it brilliantly. I never thought of the image of what you saw on the screen. I only thought in terms of the dialogue. And of course, anything that I ever wrote was so talky you could lose your mind now. Just. As Paul Jericho once said, Salt of the Earth was the only movie he had ever written that he wasn't ashamed of by the time had passed. I felt the same way, but I didn't have a Salt of the Earth. I'm embarrassed now at the movies that I was writing. But Hugo had an enormous sense of what was filmable and what wasn't. And for him, the words and the images were absolutely inseparable. He had not had the detour through theater. I mean, he studied theater, but that wasn't the medium for him. He just loved movies. And as time went on, he used to make himself sketches of what the scene looked like as he wrote it. Kind of staging them in his mind. Can I mention one nice family incident about, it was after the war. Hugo was the acting vice president of the Writers Guild. Emmett Lavery was the president. He was back east teaching at a women's college. The first vice president was James Hilton, and he was back in London for the war effort, so it fell to Hugo to be the presenter of the writing awards. And they were held at Pantages that year, Pantages Theater. We knew that his father's screenplay of Going My Way had been nominated, and so we thought it would be awfully nice if it won. But indeed, it did win, and I remember Hugo up on stage, you know, smiling as he opens the envelope, saying, "It gives me great pleasure to announce," and it was his father. Bob Hope was the MC, I remember, at that time. So that was kind of what was happening with all of us. Hugo did go into the Army for a year. He had been under contract to Paramount up until about 1940, late 43, early 44. As long as he was under contract, Paramount kept its people out of the Army. They said that they were essential to the war effort, their writers. And Hugo decided that he just couldn't stand being a contract writer anymore. And he wanted, in those days, writers felt that contracts for writers were tyranny. Metro, for instance, used to prepare or have written 100 pictures a year, and 25 would be made. And Hugo and a lot of other writers felt, oh shoot, that's ridiculous. Why, if there were more independent films, a writer would have much more independence in terms of what you could and couldn't say. Because Metro did pretty dependably commercial shows. in those days.
They were doing all the big musicals and the...
Yes, and that wasn't Hugo's bag of tea at all. So he went into the Army, thank God, and he was put, to my great relief, in at the head of a rec hall in Fort Ord. When Hugo was getting restless with contract writing at Metro, he told him he didn't want to, his contract came up for renewal. He said he didn't want to renew it. They said, this, if you renew it, it'll keep you out of the Army. And Hugo was so offended by that, that he flatly refused to take a contract, and then and started freelancing. Went to work, I think, at RKO doing From This Day Forward, or Miss Susie Slagel at Paramount. I've forgotten which came first. But while he was working on one of those two pictures, he, of course, got his notice, his welcome, you are now 1A, and of course was drafted by Spring, just before VE Day. Went in the Army just as everybody else was coming home. We got, and as soon as he had been in the Army 3 months with KP as his major contribution to the health of the U.S. Army, he was desperate to get out. So he suggested that we have another baby because three babies would do it. So our third child was conceived on the fringes of the parade ground at Fort Ord one day on a nice picnic. And as soon as she was born, he got out. In the meantime, while he was gone and I was pregnant, I wrote a novella, which lo and behold, sold to McCall's for $5,000. And Hugo was earning $35 a month as a buck private in the Army. And so I had the joyous task of telephoning him at the rec hall, having him paged, getting him on the phone, and telling him that we had just made $5,000. That was called One Road Goes Home. And I subsequently sold three more. My agent by that time I had a William Morris agent, a young man named Johnny Weber. And when the Blacklist fell, he was blacklisted out of the industry. He was kind of an official, but he was a terribly useful agent. We were just very good New Deal liberals for quite a while, but a lot was going on all over the world at that time. Roosevelt was trying to pull the country out of the Depression. There had been the war in Spain, and of course anybody in his right mind would have sided with the Democratic Army. It was the government. It was the elected government of Spain. The rebels in that case were the fascists, and we were all sharply the only people who seemed to be aware that it mattered what happened in Spain politically. Were the far left. They understood that the Germans and the Italians were trying out their weapons and such like in Spain, and we were refusing to admit more any extra Spanish loyalty. We were refusing to admit more than a carefully selected quota of Jews from Hitler Germany. The year that we joined was about, Hugo had to take out his citizenship papers first. He was Canadian born. And I think that that must have happened in about 1941. So we joined sometime after that, maybe 41, maybe afterwards, or 42. And I promptly became literature chairperson. I had to pick up, every time there was a meeting at anybody's house, I had to pick up a box of Marxist classics and take them to the meeting and try to peddle them and get people to buy them. That was my job. And for a time, I was a membership chairperson, so that we were having recruiting parties and recruiting people who never should have joined in the first place.
Okay, tell me what happened in 1951.
Okay, now, by now Hugo's out of the party. We have four children. We have a great big old house with six mortgages on it in Hollywood. And I'm, Hugo and I are both working on a little comedy for Heck Lancaster called The First Time, about the first year in the life of a young couple, of their first baby, and what it does to the marriage. And that was being prepared at Columbia, and we were going in every morning. And one morning, Hugo said, by that time, our friends, 10 of our friends were in jail. Our two best friends were Ring Lardner and Dalton Trumbo. And they had gone to jail the year before. We had gone down to the airport to see them off, and it had been very distressing. And we had been going up to Trumbo's ranch. He bought this beat up old ranch in the mountains up off the ridge route, and had dolled it all up. He'd gotten an interior decorator, and the place had been turned into a kind of Xanadu, and he called it Xanadu. Incidentally, I think I should tell you that in this matter of Hugo's being drafted, when he was drafted, he was given an honorable withdrawal by the party, because the party was so passionately devoted to the war effort, Russia being a part of it, if you remember, at that time, they were our gallant allies, and they didn't want the soldiers, who happened to be communist members, to feel any sense of divided loyalty whatsoever. So automatically, every draftee or every enlistee who was a member of the party was given given honorable withdrawal, as was his wife, me. And when Hugo got out of the army after his year in, and boy, did he look terrific when he got out of the army. He was trimmed down and brown, and he looked better than he ever looked. He was healthier than he'd ever been in his life or ever would be again. And when Hugo got out, he rejoined immediately. By that time, it was 1946. But he said to me, "Now look, I'm going to join again. Do you want to?" And I said, "Don't I?" And he said, "Well, with your writing and the PTA, which I had been recruited onto the board of, the YWCA and the PTA, which I was busy on, and by that time, four children." He said, "Christ, I'd never see you." So I said, "Okay." And I was a little relieved, because that was just one more responsibility. And so I just stayed out and lingered on the fringes. I was, I would give recruiting parties, if need be, anything that they needed from me. But I was not a member. And but Hugo went back and became a very loyal member. And by 1947, the Cold War was in effect, and you know what that meant politically. So our good friend Trumbo went off to jail. Our good friend Ring Lardner went off to jail. The other people we knew slightly, or even not at all, but we knew we were all on the same side, and that was really quite distressing, because we were beginning to sense that the United States was siding with every fascist country that we could see, it was kind of awful to have your friends in jail, for heaven's sake. So by the end of January, eight of the guys were still in jail. Two, Dimitrik and Herbert Biberman, had been given 6 month sentences by a different judge. So they were already out, and Herbert Biberman was giving speeches at cocktail parties and telling them how dreadful it was to be in jail, and how he felt like Prometheus, doomed to be chained to the rocks with the vultures tearing at his liver for the crime of bringing fire to mankind. Please. And I remember taking kind of a dim view of that comparison. But in the meantime, by the beginning of 1950, Hugo and I were working on a little comedy at Columbia for Heck Lancaster, called The First Time, a year in the life of a young couple when they've had their first baby, and all the troubles arising therefrom. And Hugo, dressing one morning for breakfast, before breakfast, said to me, "Look, Waldo got his subpoena last night. We knew that the committee people had come out again and were beginning to hand out subpoenas." He said, "They've subpoenaed Waldo." He said, "Maybe it's better if I don't come back tonight at all, if I just stay away someplace. And I said, okay. And he said, we had a date, as it happened, with Ingo Preminger, with I think Bob Eisenbach and Ian Hunter and their wives. And he said that we're going to be at such and such a restaurant, Beverly Hills or Westwood restaurant, for dinner. Why don't you put the kids to bed and come and join us? I said, fine. And that was the evening, of course. The doorbell rang after dark, dark, cold, January night. And I look through the keyhole in the door, the Judas hole in the door, and see two men in hats. And I asking for Hugo. And I said he wasn't there. And they said, when will he be back? And I said, I don't know. And they looked at each other and clearly didn't believe it and said, where can we reach him? And I knew I had to think up some good excuse for my not being able to produce him. So I said, I don't know where, I don't know. We've had a little disagreement, and I'm on the verge of tears of panic. We've had a little disagreement, and I don't know where he's gone or when he'll be back. And the two men look at each other, and they say, we'll be back, and off they go. And here are my kids in the dining room behind me having dinner. Fortunately, we had a housekeeper. And I go back, try to figure out what to do next. I'm afraid to telephone Hugo at the restaurant, because I figured that our phone is probably tapped. I'm afraid to take the car out to drive to meet him, because I figured they knew our license plate and could follow me. So I call a cab. I turn the children over to our housekeeper. I call a cab and take a bag of laundry, big bag of laundry, to the local laundromat. And from the local laundromat, which has a coin-operated telephone, I telephone first Hugo's mother and asked her to come down, who lived in the Hollywood Hills, asked her to come down, look after the children. I said, Hugo and I have, I didn't know whether her phone was being tapped, so I said, Hugo and I have had a little disagreement, and we need some time to ourselves. Can you come take care of the kids? So she was utterly dismayed, because we had a very good relationship. Then I telephoned the restaurant where Hugo was, and said, and when they paged him, he came on the phone. I said, honey, get on your horse. And there was a pause, and he said, no shit. So that was the beginning. Hugo's stepfather drove me out to the restaurant where our friends were. Ian offered his sister's place to sleep at. Hugo never came home, and I decided that I'd better not. So I went to, the way it worked out, the two older children who were in school, in Cherimoya Avenue School, stayed at Hugo's mother's, because she lived very close. The two younger children, one of whom was about 18 months, and one of whom was about four, would have been in kindergarten, who was in kindergarten, I took to my mother's, and she lived down near Hancock Park area, white bread part of town. And the housekeeper, I, our cat, and the two youngest children went to my mother's. And Hugo, but we were terrified, of course, of turning up at work. We did. They were already getting rid of people who had been named. So the blacklist was already underway. In fact, one of the reasons that the original 10 did not take the fifth was that the fifth would get you just as blacklisted as the first. And with the first, you were at least placing your protest on constitutional grounds.
With the fifth, though, you looked guilty. You looked guilty.
That's the point. It implies guilt. Hugo said to Harold Hecht the next morning, when we meet at work, Harold, this flu epidemic that is all over town, it looks very bad to me, and I think we should all leave town until it blows over, so none of us will catch anything. And Harold, deadpan, gives him a long, piercing look and says, how long do you think the epidemic's going to last? Hugo said, I don't know, but I think we better get away from it. Harold said, okay, how about Palm Springs? So within a couple of days, we were on our way out of town, that time with the children and the housekeeper and Hugo's mother. And with Hugo's mother, under Hugo's mother's name, we rented a little place in Palm Springs. And we kept bumping into more blacklistees than you can shake a stick at down in Palm Springs, all on the run. We bumped into, Hugo went to get a haircut, and the man in the next chair with a towel over his face was getting it shaved, takes the towel off, and it's Mickey Uris who was on the run. And we bump into a man that looks familiar coming out of a restaurant in Palm Springs, and it was Lewis Allen, who later adopted the Rosenberg kids. He has a different name, but he and Hugo look at each other, and Hugo said, "Oh, well, we thought we'd come down to get away from the flu epidemic," and Lewis Allen says, or maybe it's Allen Lewis. I'm not quite sure which way it went. There was a Lewis Allen and an Allen Lewis, both of them on the left, and I wish they wouldn't. Allen Lewis or Lewis Allen said, "Yeah, it's a bad epidemic."
Okay, now do you want to talk about the Rosenbergs later? Or do you want to bring that up now?
Well, I tried not to. I was so horrified by the whole story. I didn't know the facts of the case. I knew that the government was persecuting anybody they could lay their hands on, but I also didn't know whether there was a shred of guilt or not, or I didn't even know what constituted espionage anymore. You knew that the United States had locked up in concentration camps people of Japanese ancestry who were American citizens, American born. If they had had Japanese parents or grandparents, they were put in concentration camps, and that to us was the first step to American concentration camps. And the thought that they might, the bill that had been passed in, I've forgotten, in the about 46, I think, the McCarran Act, gave the government the right to intern, quote, suspected spies or saboteurs in time of war or insurrection. And you knew that the government was going to be the one to define what was a time of war or insurrection, and what was and who constituted suspected spies or saboteurs. So it seemed to us terribly unwise to stay in the United States, terribly. After Palm Springs, I think we headed for the rest of the company, Hecht and Lancaster, and the nice, great, big director that we had, whose name I'll remember later, went back to Los Angeles, to Hollywood, and we headed out. Parceled the children out, went to Newport Beach, and I was visiting. I had driven down all this time. Of course, we weren't telling Hugo's father what was going on at all. We weren't telling my mother much, and we weren't telling her anything of our plans. She didn't know that we were in Palm Springs, and at one point she found out we were down there, but she didn't know where we were. She went out. She drove out to Palm Springs looking for us. But we didn't. She had talked. She'd been visited by the FBI and asked questions about us, and she said subsequently to us, "Well, I had to answer them. I had to answer my country's questions." So we felt that she was not a dependable confidant. Hugo's mother was totally loyal to Hugo, and that was all that mattered. So she was in on most of our troubles. Anyway, I was visiting Hugo's Hugo's stepmother down the coast in Oceanside, near Oceanside, and driving home, twilight along the coast, listening to the car radio, and I suddenly hear the announcer saying that the committee has given out the names of the people that they've been unable to reach, whom they want to serve subpoenas on, to question, and it included Hugo. It included Fred Rinaldo, Bobby Lease, I forget, Paul Jericho, and Hugo Butler, among others. And now I knew that we could no longer maintain this fiction that nothing was going on. So I got back to Newport Beach and having figured out that we'd better implement our plan. We had made, when Trumbull got out of jail, which was maybe a month and a half before this particular news announcement, he and Hugo had decided roughly on going to Mexico, because Trumbull had found out that there was a good American school down there. I, in the meantime, didn't want to leave until the end of the school year till June, because I didn't want the children to miss school. How middle class can you get? So now we know that we can no longer wait. So Hugo, in the meantime, has been picked up by a friend of, by Ring's ex-wife, I think, and her then husband, all upset about the same announcement. And they have proposed taking him, driving him to Mexico. So that's what he's going to do when I go back to Los Angeles to join the children, to ride out the rest of the school year.
And but, at this point, there's no problem with you being there. They're not looking for
well,
you.
Well, we didn't know. We didn't know, but we knew that Hugo was much hotter than I was. And also, didn't know how much attention they wanted to pay to wives, whether they really cared, particularly since I was no longer active, really active in the party, a real member, and Hugo was. So we decide that so Hugo has a whole adventure. From Tijuana, he takes a plane to Mexico City, where he falls in with John Bright, Bob Rawson, John Wexley, and I forget who else. And he and John Wexley fly down to Acapulco with John Wexley's wife. And Hugo sees the tropics and just, oh boy, did he love them. And John caught a sailfish. He took Hugo out sailfishing one day, and John caught a sailfish. And at the end of that particular day, John had ordered the sailfish, the fins and the head, I think, sent up to Monterey to be stuffed and mounted. And Hugo is meeting them on their terrace overlooking Acapulco Bay, and they're both feeling triumphant, and the sun is setting, and there's a nightclub downstairs in this hotel where the bongo drums are beginning. And you could see this, you know, the ocean is a sheet of, a blazing sheet of light. And Hugo is having this long, cold drink, and he says, just think, Collins and Berkeley could have had all this. So
they too could have been blacklisted.
Yes.
Run out of their country.
Right.
Oh.
Anyway, so but then he flew back to Ensenada, because that had been our interim plan, to try it for the summer, to see if it worked for us, to see how we liked living in another country. Because you weren't too committed if you were only across the border and down a little ways. And Hugo went then to Ensenada and said, you know, as soon as you feel you can take the kids out of school, come on down and we'll give it a go. So by, I guess, May 30th, I had arranged for the children to miss the last couple of weeks of school. And I loaded the car. I had to go back and close up the house. Terrified that somebody would see that there was some life there and send for a U.S. Marshal, but nobody came. We stayed this summer, that one summer, in Ensenada, and the Trumbos would have to sell their ranch, so they couldn't leave for a while. But Ring and Ian Hunter, who was the fourth member of that particular little group of friends, all decided they too would join us in Mexico. When we finally made the drive down into the interior. And we got to Mexico City. Oh, the trip. All summer long, blacklistees came down to Ensenada to visit. It was a very adventurous summer. It was a wonderful summer, but that's all in the book. Anyway, by late October, Trumbull notifies us that the ranch is going into escrow, and they can meet us the 1st of November in San Diego. So we pack up again and head for San Diego the 1st of November. And we get there, meet the Trumbos, but Nikki Trumbo has a strep throat. So we have to wait 3 days in Ensenada and hope that nobody figures out where any of us are. And the Trumbos party consists of the two Trumbos, three children, and a great big sheepdog. And our party consisted of the two adult butlers, four children, and our Siamese cat. So wherever we go, we have to plan this rather indigestible group. So the men figure out with maps that they will spend, that they will call ahead about 200, 250 miles each day. And that's what we did all the way down, except that every single stop, a new child came down with a strep throat. And we had to spend 3 days, you know, till the child was, the fever was down and well enough, the child was well enough to travel.
So, oh my goodness, that's quite the story. I didn't know that.
Oh yeah, that was, so then even the trip down was an adventure. And we got to Mexico City. Well, we got first to Guadalajara, and by that time, the two boys, 10-year-old Mike and 10-year-old Chris Trumbo, our 10-year-old Mike, both came down with strep throat, and they were the sickest of the whole bunch. That was Guadalajara. So we were marooned there for a couple of weeks. And Trumbo and Hugo decided to fly ahead to Mexico City and find us both houses, which they did. And we got to Mexico City. Oh, we stopped and visited a volcano on our way. There was a brand new volcano called Paracutin in Michoacan, and we stopped. We made one stop, went out 4 o'clock in the morning, and saw this newly born volcano. It was fascinating. It had buried a whole little valley town, nothing but church spires sticking up.
And so then how did the kids view this?
It was just a wonderful adventure, complete adventure. And the kids, Nikki Trumbo, who was 13 on that trip, taught the older kids a song as follows, which they sang all the way down. Leprosy, my God, I've got leprosy. There goes my eyeball into my highball. There goes my chin into my gin. The whole trip down. And we're looking at the Spanish aqueducts and wonderful little Mexican Spanish villages and having a great time. Here are these kids involved in telling each other science fiction stories.
So this was not a bitter,
it was
terrible.
An adventure. And we were trying to, you know, we were trying to make life as much fun for the kids as we could under the circumstances. So we get down to Mexico, and Trumbos have this little marble mausoleum that they've rented. Trumbo always had a love for the lavish, and Hugo had rented a very workable, nice house with a whole lot of bedrooms about a mile from the Trumbos' place, from a woman whose father we had heard had been known as the Red Governor of Michoacan, and. She met us, and she was a darling, and she then had six children, and she said, you know, my husband is a diputado. One day he will be presidente, but right now he is only a diputado. And we said, yes, yes, Echeverria. So he became a president of Mexico some years later. Anyway, so we Trumbo stayed in their house. We spent 6 months in. And by the just before Christmas, Ian Hunter and his wife and one child came down, and the Lardners and their three children, his, hers, and theirs came down.
And how long did you stay in Mexico?
Well, we all differed. Hugo and I stayed until 60, the end of 60. The Trumbos stayed about, 3 years. The Hunters stayed a year, and the Lardners stayed 6 months. While we were still in Ensenada, the summer of 1951, we hear, I've forgotten how we heard, that our credit on the first time was being disputed, or that that Hecht wanted to remove our names, and there was an arbitration. And we had a wire from Ring Lardner. He'd been put on the arbitration board, and he wired that our credit, and we got first credit. And the other two names were put after our names. But Harold took our names off for a time. And I don't know at what point he put them back on. Somewhere. And we didn't have to do anything about that. I don't know whether it was within a year or how long. I'm unsure about that, and I've never known. But I do know that by the time the Guild got busy to restoring credits, we were already back on.
Now, in So Young, So Bad, it said in collaboration.
So Young, So Bad, I had worked on that with the director, Bernie Vorhaus. Bernie shared a story credit with me on that, but he was the director. And I had done that sometime before. Fortunately, thank God, for a piece of the action. I don't know whether it was the net or the gross. I had almost no salary on it. I'm not sure I got anything, any cash. But it was one of the things that supported us all through our first year in Mexico. By the way, when we got to Mexico City, December 1951, Hugo went downtown and to buy the newspapers to see what was playing. And there were maybe a dozen or so foreign pictures there, non-Spanish, Mexican pictures. English, French, American. Four had been written by Hugo or me or both of us. Well, that's what we got down to Mexico to.
That's great. Now, Hugo ended up working with Buñuel in Mexico.
Well, now, while we were working for on the first time with Harold Hecht, Hugo was sharply aware that the blow might fall at any time, although we couldn't quite believe it. You know it and you deny it at the same time. So that he had been preparing something, a script for Mexico that he thought might be useful, might be very cheaply shot. And he planned it so that it would cost almost nothing to shoot. An adaptation of Robinson Crusoe. He was also reading some material that Joe Losey was going to be working on, which subsequently became the Long Night or the Big Night, which he was working on while he was on the road, while we were still up in California. He and Joe Losey were going from motel to motel with their typewriters and their yellow pads writing this movie. We never really knew what happened to that one. But then down in Mexico, Hugo in the meantime had sent it down. He had sent the copy of his manuscript down to George Pepper, who had been the head of one of the leftist kind of quote front groups, but it was a legitimate liberal political action group. George had been a musician and a member of the musicians union, and George had gone down to Mexico City just ahead, he thought, of a possible subpoena. And a lot of musicians had given him money to invest if he found anything useful to invest in. A lot of people who were afraid of the Blacklist. So George had found a way to get the script to Luis Buñuel. And Luis Buñuel loved it, wanted to, you know, do it his own way, of course, because Luis Buñuel always does. But by the time we got down, Hugo was already lined up to work with Luis Buñuel on. Well, at that point, we had never seen a Buñuel picture. We didn't know what that meant, really, but we soon found out. And the preparation for that picture, Hugo found more fascinating than any writing experience he'd ever had in his life, except maybe working with Jean Renoir, which was pretty good once upon a time, on The Southerner. He'd been very excited about that, too. But this was just mind-boggling. And it meant that he and Buñuel always, to get away from distraction in his final rewrites, always took his writers to a resort, usually a spa, where that you can work and just not be interrupted by anything. And that's what they did with Robinson Crusoe, while I was getting, you know, investigating the American school and getting the kids enrolled. And by the Mexican schools had winter vacations, because summers were just, this whole central of Mexico is drowned in rain. So December, January were the long school vacations. Something like 53, 54, Bob Aldrich came down. He had asked Hugo very early in our stay to do a screenplay for him, a fast one, which he referred to as a Sand and Tits picture. And Hugo had written one over a weekend, and we'd gotten something like, I don't know, $2,500 for it or something. And that had been made into a movie, the name of which I will remember in time, but you have restored the credit on that one, too. Bob and Hugo had kept up their relationship. Bob had been the, I think, an assistant or second assistant on the Southerner, which is when they had met. And by now, Bob is building his own career as a director, and he's always anxious to have one picture in the works and one in preparation. And when he came down to do Veracruz and told Hugo he wanted an inexpensive picture to do, and Hugo gave him my second novella in McCall's, Bob said, great. And that was about a family member who was a psychopathic liar that I had turned into the novella. And Bob turned into a script, and this was Joan Crawford. It turned into Autumn Leaves, because Bob's concept was to have Nat King Cole's voice overshot singing this, and Joan Crawford would play the lead, and he got Cliff Robertson, very young, to play the young psychopathic liar. And it turned into quite a good picture. There was some work done on it up here by two other writers, but I think one of them added a character so that she would have somebody to talk to. Bob said he would need a front for that picture, because by now producers were getting very wary about about buying any scripts with a name they didn't recognize, because they figured that it could be a nom de plume. So now we got our old, Hugo's old friend Jack Jevney, whom he had worked with on Wyoming and Roughshod, as I remember, to front for us. And Jack, who had written silent movies, Douglas Fairbanks silent movies, I think including the Black Pirate even, was sweet. He was a lovely man, and he was happy to do it. So we got all together $5,500 or $5,500, of which we gave Jack a quarter. That was the going rate for fronts in those days. And what he got for that was the original material, my screenplay, Hugo's rewrite with me of my screenplay. And you don't get rich when you have to work under the table. You can keep working busily, but you don't get rich.
Was the other movie The Miracle?
The Miracle happened because Hugo's father, the summer of 1955, we came up to Ensenada again, because my mother was dying of cancer. Hugo's father was very upset, having a lot of trouble, because he was not happy about his stepson-in-law, and he and his wife were squabbling constantly about this. And he had been given the miracle to do. He had accepted it because he thought Hugo could come up and work with him on it under the table. And unfortunately, another family member said, well, if he comes up, I'm going to tell a U.S. Marshal. So poor Frank telephoned us over a New Year's Day in tears, saying, I can't do this to Hugo. And Hugo called him back and proposed sending me up instead. Frank was feeling old. He didn't feel that he could handle the assignment all by himself. So it was school holiday. I take up our son Mike, who barely knows his grandfather, and we spend much of January with Hugo's mother and stepfather in this restrictive covenant colony of St. Malo, where Jews aren't allowed to come within 10 miles. And Frank and I work out the problems, because it's on the Catholic Index. It was a tough, it was a tough problem, but we solved that one easily enough. So, and then from there, I came back and did the first draft of we took care of the story. I came back to Mexico and did the first draft of every scene, mailed it up to Frank, who did the polish and sent it into Warner Brothers. And it got made.
Under his name.
Under his name.
So, and what happens after you've been in Mexico for a while and you're moving on?
Well, let's see. Hugo's blood pressure went up. Hugo was put Hugo's doctor didn't know that Hugo was complaining of fatigue. He was having trouble working as hard as he had to work to make this thing go, to keep us all. And I had two more babies down in Mexico, to his utter dismay. So all he could see was just an endless lifetime of hard work to get all these six kids through college. And he didn't know when, if ever, he would be out from under the table. and he was working terribly hard. And what I didn't know was that it was doing dreadful things to his system. He told our U.S. doctor that he was very tired at about the same time that Trumbo did when he, on his visits north. No, by that time, Trumbo was already up here. The same doctor fed Trumbo and Hugo amphetamines because he thought they were non-addictive. And what that did to Hugo's blood pressure was just send it right up through the... But it didn't occur to him that that was what was doing it. It also made him very short-tempered. It was very hard on us. So as toward the end of the decade, Hugo was coming into me and saying, you know, I'm going to have to stop driving in Mexico or start carrying a gun because I'm getting too sore at these bastards, meaning the other drivers. He, you know, road rage. And he had also, we had begun to fall in love with Italy from a distance. There were wonderful articles in Life and Look magazine, of Life or Look magazine, with showing the Italian countryside with huge restaurant tables of food in the foreground. And that really turned Hugo on. So he had started writing some originals. By the way, and in the meantime, I had sold two of my stories toward the end of the decade. One to 17, and one to a British magazine called Housewife, which I sold to as a three-part serial. I had gotten, thank God, an agent from the Maltzes, Margaret Maltz had sold a book, and her agent was a dear old-time editor translator named Bartold Fless, who remained my agent for years after, until he died of old age. And Bartold sold one of these two stories. Hugo, in the meantime, was getting more and more tense. And his last picture with Buñuel had gone to Cannes. It had gotten a special award. This was the young one, which upset me very badly. I felt that it was a terribly amoral picture. I was very concerned about it. And I couldn't have told you why, except that it was, I think that it, Hugo was far too forgiving of his protagonist. And Buñuel, who was the gentlest man in the world in real life, who would never swat a fly or kill a spider inside the house, he would capture it and take it outside. But his favorite sport was skeet shooting, and he considered it his duty to wean Hugo from his Manichaean attitudes. Or so he says in his autobiography. He felt that this, you know, was very bad for an artist to be too moralistic in his approach to life. So here was this picture that upset me dreadfully. And it really kind of made Hugo's reputation, really, under his nom de plume. That was written under nom de plume. And Buñuel had gone back to Cannes. He'd gone to Cannes with the picture, and it had won, and then he'd gone to Spain for the first time since the revolution.
What was Hugo's nom de plume?
He had two. When he did two docudramas down there. He kind of invented docudrama for himself. He didn't know that other people were inventing docudrama elsewhere. And when he did the docudramas, he was known as Hugo Mozo. And Mozo means houseboy in Spanish, or butler. But when he did an American picture, he was H.B. Addis. And he was passed off on the set of Robinson Crusoe as a Canadian oil man who had struck oil and had invested some of his earnings in the picture. So he was treated with great respect as H.B. Addis and did his rewriting at night, you know. Nobody knew that he was a secret writer.
Now on to, so we go to Italy.
Okay, now, it is now 1960, and sometime in the summer, Hugo got a wire from Bob Aldrich saying, can you come Italy 6 weeks, rewrite biblical subject? First class tickets for you and Jean. So Hugo said, yes, yes, yes. He was desperate, really. By that time, it was too hard to get. Mexico is terribly xenophobic about America, and you can understand why. It's known as the giant of the North, It's just, it's like growing up as the permanent little brother. So, and even people whom they feel sympathy toward, like the blacklistees, find it very difficult to do anything because the xenophobia affects the hiring. And anyway, so Bob Aldrich sent Hugo this invitation, and again, he said, let me go over there and see how long a job, maybe we can even make it stretch it out, maybe we can even live there. So we got the children, we put the children all on their own passports. Hugo left, I packed everything up, ready to ship if need be, knowing that we would have a friend who would do it for us. And I rejoined him a month earlier than the children's school let out. We got Hugo's stepfather, because his mother was not well. His stepfather came down to stay with the children the last month. Hugo left the end of August, or of the end of September. I left the end of October to join him, and the children were put aboard the plane and shipped over to us the end of November, when school let out. And in the meantime, let's see what had happened. Hugo had gone over to, he discovered, oh, let me, please let me, I'm anxious to tell you what I think is really the theme music of this whole story. The night that I got over to Italy, Italy was in the middle of a presidential campaign, and it was all over the place, the campaign. It was just, it was also in the middle of an enormous boom. Everybody in the world was buying Italian goods and Italian movies and Italian shoes and Italian automobiles. And Hugo and Bob had done their, you know, had already sounded out they were going to be shooting the picture in Morocco someplace. In the meantime, this particular night, he says, "There's something I've got to show you." So in the little car that he has bought, a little Austin Cooper 7 with his first money, he drives me downtown to Piazza del Popolo. And the Piazza del Popolo by then is all lit up, home-going Italians, all, even the work people are chic and busy and looking prosperous. And the cars, lovely little Italian cars are whizzing by us in every direction. Here's the Piazza del Popolo, which is a huge piazza, and all lit up, and there are banners strung across from one side of this enormous plaza to the other. And one of them, Hugo points out to me, says, "Vota Comunista." And Hugo said, "Look at that. Isn't that great? I sure as hell hope they don't win, but isn't it great to see it there?" And that's the tagline of the book.
So you wrote Face in the Rain?
I was, again, Hugo was busy on something. Hugo bumped into, while we were in Italy, Hugo bumped into Haskell Wexler and John Kelly, who I think became head of Metro for a while. But in the meantime, they were just over there looking for a project. They had kind of pinched the outline of a Yugoslav story that they had, I don't know whether they had the rights to it or not, but they wanted our version of it written, and Hugo couldn't do it right then, so as he customarily did, he passed it on to me. So I went up to Pisa and with the company and was writing it like mad. And then at a certain point, I came back and Hugo went up. When Hugo was able to, I came back to be with the children, and he came up and worked on the screenplay. The final draft was really far more his than mine, but that was, every morning waking up and looking out your window to the piazza, to the Campo Santo, and seeing that crazy tower is worth the price of admission. We did not come straight home from Italy after. Hugo had done two other things. He'd done a picture with Joe Losey called Eva, or Eve. Eva, I've forgotten whether it's Eve or Eva, from a book. And one other picture, and we were not sure that the States was the right place for us. We still didn't like what we were hearing. So we When things got pretty slow in Italy, we came back to Mexico for a year and a half. And at that point, and Hugo began to we both were commuting back and forth. Hugo took a motel room up in Hollywood to do a and went to work on a Four for Texas rewrite for Bob Aldrich. I don't know whether he ever earned a credit on that or not. We stayed a year and a half in Mexico, and basically the reason that we came back to the States at all was that we didn't like what looked like the Mexican, remember, five of our children were girls. And Hugo didn't like the fate of the Mexican woman. She was either the other woman in the Casa Chica, the custom of the Casa Chica, or she was the betrayed wife, and it's not a very happy choice in either case. And he felt that was a bum trip, because we knew if we stayed that they would make their lives in Mexico. And by that time, we had two kids in college up in the States anyway. Our boy was at Columbia, and our girl was at Harvard. And four children coming up. So, but primarily because, for a variety of reasons, I think also that he was beginning not to feel very good. I think he sensed that he was not in good shape. So we came up, we came back to the States, moved back up, the end of 1964. Hugo found a house for us. By now we're having a really hard time between it, together. I mean, his personality changes, and he'd had his adventure, and that had damn near killed me. So I was struggling to keep the family together, because we had gotten through the whole Blacklist because we were a unit. And it was desperately important for me that we take care of each other. But it was terribly difficult with Hugo in the shape that he was in. And while we were, right after we moved back to the States, Bob Aldrich got him to come over to England to work on Lila Clare. And Hugo was a wreck by then. He was having dreams and thinking they were real. His sense of what was appropriate behavior was gone. That's something that we did not anticipate, was that when we came back to the States, we thought we could just pick up our careers. We had gotten, Bob Aldrich had put our names on Lila Clare, and the producer of the Losey picture had put Hugo's name on as for adaptation of Eva, and Face in the Rain had both our names on. So we felt that it would be fairly easy to pick up our careers where we'd left off. Well, it wasn't just a lap dissolve. We found that by that time, nobody was interested in what you'd done before. They wanted to know your recent credits. And there were there was nothing that we could point to, because you couldn't betray the people who had invested in your movies on the grounds that you were using a nom de plume.
And you lost out on other things like the WGA pension.
Oh yes. Hugo had gotten, I think, a leave of absence from the Guild at some point. I think he had an attorney work that out, so that I who had joined in 1941, qualified in 40 and joined in 41, have long been a 50-year member, but I had those 14 years out of the country, and on a leave of absence, Hugo came back, but it was very rough for him. He was finding himself no longer, he was finding it very difficult to write, very difficult, and he worked on. Bob was extremely concerned, because Hugo's stuff wasn't making real sense. And that's when I fell heir to what he was doing on when he could no longer do it, I was picking up where he left off on Lila Clare.
So, and then 4 years later, he passed away. Was it 1968?
Well, it was released. I worked on it later after Hugo died, too. I did some work on it then. But also, I was trying to cover for him while he was alive.
How did it feel to have your credits restored recently by the Guild?
Delicious. Again, a lap dissolve. By the time, 1996, 97, the Guild began to investigate this whole matter, and they were going to try to restore the credits to the Blacklistees. Now, it didn't mean anything in terms of money, but it certainly meant a lot in terms of the honor of the thing. So I've given the Guild all the information that I had. I gave them my whole correspondence on my voluminous correspondence on the miracle, because that was all written by mail. So I had a vast amount of work to show for the time, and we got our credits back in kind, I think, two chunks. And it was terribly gratifying. It would be very nice, you know, if the pension had been attached too. But I could understand that it would be very difficult to get even our friends' approval to our taking the credits away from them if it meant that they were going to lose their royalties. So and also I knew that it must have been difficult to negotiate with management this whole thing if it was going to cost them money in lost residuals too, along with everything else. I knew that, I mean, I was aware, and I may be wrong, I've never talked to anybody about the process, the negotiating process that led to this, that made management willing to do it. I was delighted that they did, but I knew that it must have taken some sort of quid pro quo to get us here. In the 70s, after Hugo died, I kind of became a full-time Guild participant in every way, and I guess it also took care of my social my feeling of need to be socially useful. So I translated all the feelings that I'd had formerly for the Communist Party over to the Guild, and quite early on, I quite soon after Hugo's death, I joined the Women's Committee at the Guild and became very active, and I was co-chair for either the second or the third year of its existence. And we did at that time, there were about 19% of the Guild membership was women, and they were only getting something like 12% of the money. There was clearly a discrepancy, and there were a lot of show after show that never gave a job to a woman. The two women who were highly successful getting jobs on series television were women who used their initials, D.C. Fontana, and Margaret Armin used M. Armin, and nobody knew what the M stood for, as nobody knew what the D.C. stood for, and they were the ones who got sent out on pitch sessions. But otherwise, and we got one lovely line that was spoken to Ollie Crawford, I think. The general, when there was a hospital series called, I think, General Hospital, Ollie once said to their story editor, "How come you never use any women writers?" And they didn't. And this man said, "Well, we tried one once and it didn't work out, so we haven't had any more since."
Oh God, that's so killer.
That was the attitude of the average producer or story editor toward women writers. But when we did our survey and got the exact figures of which shows had how many episodes, how many men writers, how many women writers, and it was so catastrophic, it was so astonishing. We gave it to Len Chassman, who was then executive. Len took it, appended had it all typed up, Xeroxed, appended a letter saying, "There are laws against discrimination. This is what employment looks like at the Writers Guild. Do you feel you have obeyed the law?" Just a gentle push. And out it went, and instantly it was a whole different atmosphere. after Hugo's death, I really had felt a desperate need to be more of a mensch than I had ever been before, because I still had very small children to raise. The youngest was 9, and two in college, and one was married. Two were married. Anyway, I had a job of work to do, and I was approached by Bob Eisenbach, whom I had known at Stanford, who had interviewed me when I was an actress and just returned to the campus, and he was a reporter for the Stanford Daily. Bob called and said that two of his clients were Frank and Doris Hursley, who were head writers of two. They had just invented General Hospital. They had created General Hospital, and they had another soap called Bright Promise, and they were looking for associate writers. And so I went to work for them. They loved me, and I learned soap writing while I was doing it with these two terribly prolific people. I didn't know that they had a daughter named Bridget Dobson, who would become my boss on other series. But in the meantime, I went to work for them and worked about 20 months on their soap with Dana Andrews and some other good people. And that it didn't last too long, because they went on to another show, and they were replaced by a couple of other head writers who didn't quite understand the feeling for the show, and it died. But after that, I just moved on from. I spent about 10 years in on soaps, a little bit longer, and never wanted to be a head writer because I didn't think I was good enough on story. But associate writing was an associate writer. Now, I better at this point get down to a description of how this whole thing works. It's a team. It's a team job, and you need to understand what is expected from each member, each kind of writer. The head writer manages the story, the long-term story, writes a year or two-year outline ahead, each year or 2 years, projecting. He doesn't have to stay with it, but the sponsors need to know that he has a plan. So. They write what's known as the long-term projection, the head writers, and that then is broken up into 13-week increments. Those are story kind of segments, and they know exactly what portion of their long-term projection is going to be included in the next 13 weeks. Now, in those days, when soaps were half an hour, it was possible for the head writers to do their own daily outlines, what were known as the breakdowns, and that the 13-week segments were in turn broken down. They had a rough idea how the story would progress Friday to Friday to Friday, with always a crisis and a tag on Friday. The associate writers, they had two or three associate writers, because we could write average 2.5 scripts a week, so that was not too difficult. You were busy every moment of your life, of course. You got your outline on Monday morning once it had been approved for the week and for the day. So you had, and you were told which one was yours or which ones were yours. But you also knew, because each outline was pretty complete, you knew where you fitted in the week's events. It was like putting the fender on a car that's moving past you on a log of some sort. Originally, when I went to work for the Hursleys, the shows were half an hour, and I did, as I say, 2.5 of those a week. And those scripts were about 30 pages long. It's quite easy writing, because you're given a very complete, the breakdown tells you what happens in every scene. All you have to do is show it happening. And I always tried to enrich the scenes as much as I could, to throw in as many little human details, because goodness knows I'd had a lot of experience with 6 children. So I tried to make it as good as I possibly could. I knew that it was a kind of godchild, or not a godchild, orphan, an adoptee of other writers. It was somewhat scorned. And I tried to make up for it by doing the best work I absolutely could. I don't think I could have worked on it if I hadn't been allowed to do that. Right. So I got several awards during my soap opera career, not from my film career, but from my soap opera career. And sometime, and I think that it was, I went from Bright Promise to Search for Tomorrow, which I worked on with Ted Apstein as my head writer, and he was a lovely man to work for. And he knew too what I was aiming for, trying to give a touch of quality to this stuff, and like that idea. So I don't remember whether it was right then, whether it was on that show, or I went from there to Guiding Light. And it was, I guess maybe on Guiding Light, I started at half an hour and went to an hour. By that time, the scripts were all going to an hour. And that meant that I could only do one a week, which was the average. So that by that, by that time also, the head writer could no longer, the pure work involved in an hour show, planning a 2-year, planning major stories plus minor ones, always four or five major stories, plus maybe four or five on the that are kind of simmering along on the back burner, your minor stories, plus what's happening through the 13-week cycle, plus more or less, roughly, you've got a pretty good idea what's going to be happening every week, week by week, what major events. They're steps along a continuum. So by that time, the head writers were beginning to use what we call breakdown writers. And they would have two or three of those. Each show would have two or three breakdown writers who would, again, work as a team, and each one would do his two or three stories that week, his storylines. And the breakdowns would go from 11 pages to, there were breakdowns for an hour's show. There were breakdowns on, for instance, General Hospital or Santa Barbara that ran almost 30 pages. So it's very, they're worked out very completely. I mean, they know each writer can only use the sets and the characters that he is allowed to use, because it's all budgeted. The move from screenwriting to soap was a little awkward for me, because I had when I went to work for the Dobsons, the Hursley's daughter and her husband, I was finding that my shows were coming back just blue penciled out of all recognition, and I thought, oh dear, this is not going to last very long. And I had all these young children, and they were going to have to be sent to college somehow. And I told Jeff Corey, an actor who lived about three houses up the street and who was an old friend, blacklisted friend, that I was having some trouble. My scripts were being rewritten, and I said, maybe it's something. I said that the sponsors, the last time P&G was out, they said something about subtext. Maybe that's what I'm missing. Jeff says, subtext, that's what I work with. He said, why don't you come and watch my class, do improvs. I give them the subtext and they do the improvs. And I said, well, I can't come Saturdays because that's when my script is due. He said, well, just come and watch once or twice. And I went, and it was the first time that I had ever learned, and it's a heck of a time in a lifetime of writing, how important subtext is. It had never occurred to me that you wrote a scene and didn't say what the scene was about. And suddenly, I'm finding out that the really good scenes are the scenes when the subtext isn't mentioned, but skirted around. The minute you talk about something, the steam comes out of the tension. The tension vanishes the minute certain things are said. And suddenly I am learning for the first time in my life that you write, that you must write for daytime about what is not being said. So there I was, somewhat of a ripe old age, probably about maybe almost 60 by then. And I worked 5 years on Guiding Light, and then P&G took our whole, we had built it up to a big hit again. So they took our whole team and put it on As the World Turns. And I worked on that for about 2.5 years. And then the Dobsons, by that time, the youth thing, the youth adoration, the infinite respect for the young of your audience had come into being, and they wanted to target the show to the teenagers. And they looked at me, and I was then about 60. By that time, I was 66. And they said, we're going to have to let you go. We need younger writers. So I wrote them one of the best shows I had ever written as my swan song, and got off. And from then on, then I began to teach and write. At that point, my beloved agent, bless him, began to get me book deals. So I was, every time I was unemployed in Hollywood, I had a book, little book deal with that Bart Fluss had gotten me. Biographies, young adults, biographies, gothic, all
now,
kinds of stuff.
Gosh, that spurned a question. You have written a lot of young adult books. Is that one of the genres you like to write for?
It's something that you can get a deal on ahead of time. I decided after five of these things that if any writer who wrote on spec was an amateur. It was the sign of the amateur. You didn't write unless you had a deal. And my Bart Fluss had gotten me. And by the way, Bart Fluss's, an early client of Bart Fluss's had been Whitaker Chambers. You can imagine how uneasy that had made me feel. However, our paths never crossed, I'm happy to say. Anyway, the first book he got me was a juvenile, and I had never tried a juvenile. It was Harriet Beecher Stowe, and he thought that anybody with six children could certainly write a book about a woman who had seven. And indeed, I found I loved it. I worked out my own system of researching and writing, loved it. He then got me, and this is often between soap jobs, by the way. He then got me young adults on Benito Juarez and on Pancho Villa. And then he got me a gothic. And I remember coming to the dinner table one night when my oldest daughter was having dinner with me saying, a gothic, Bart's just got me a deal for a gothic. I don't know how to write a gothic. And my daughter said, oh yes you do. You remember my interview for the job of governess for Charles Bronson and his wife? Take that, and you've got to put my English teacher, Mr. Desmond O'Grady, who was a slightly drunken but wonderful, wonderfully talented teacher at her English school in Rome, and he's got to be in it. And and she laid it all out for me. So yes, I did that one. And that just went to pay. That stayed in paperback, but I did make a fair amount of money on that one. And then when I lost my job completely, Bart got me a job writing for a book on how to write for soap opera.
What do you tell is the key? You teach it at UCLA Extension.
I taught it at UCLA Extension first, and after that at USC Film School. The big secret, of course, the storylines. You have got to get the sound of the actors right. Every actor, by the time he's a soap star, he has his own sound. And you cannot write a soap script unless you have tracked the show for at least a month and get the sound of that show and know how these people speak and what kinds of things they say and what they don't say. My other strongest advice to film students who are studying soap is that all soap is Greek tragedy. It's got to be character-based. It's got to be. And you have got to understand your character. You've got to understand his conscious motivation, unspoken, and his unconscious motivation. What happened to him before this story even began to make him like this? So that you know what kind of thing you're dealing with, what kind of character you're dealing with, what he would and wouldn't do, even if he doesn't understand it himself. So let me think. So that there's a certain inevitability about what happens, about the story developments. I've done so many different kinds of writing, and I guess each new one is a challenge because I'm self-taught in each case. I have to teach myself how to do that particular kind of thing. When you're writing young adults, for instance, or when you're writing juveniles, you realize that part of it is language. You must phrase things simply. with young adults, you can be a little bit more complex, but you have to be very clear in your mind about place. You have to be as graphic as you can be to bring it to life. You can't just write prosily. You can't just say, this happened. You've got to bring it to life. It's got to become real to these kids who are reading it. And it's got to be vivid. But you have to be accurate, because it's a no-no to, it really is, to invent in biography. Or, and if you speculate, you have to say it is speculation. And I found little tricks. I found, for instance, when I was bringing Benito Juarez up to Mexico City, where he was about to become president after the crisis, I saw that the date was the date of his arrival in Mexico City was like the second or the third of November, and I knew that the Day of the Dead is a wonderful holiday in Mexico and wonderfully vivid. So I said, perhaps as he was making his way north, as his carriage was bringing him closer to Mexico City, he stopped to witness the ceremony of the Day of the Dead. If you say perhaps, you're justifying it. and you're also having the fun of bringing a piece of real color to the work. So that, and how you keep track of the dates of the events and the page of the reference on which you find mention of this event, you have to keep track of. That was a huge paste and scissor job, just enormous. Before you begin to, you're building your own outline with scissors. And Gothic, as I say, I understood Gothic. Rebecca is the classic, and all of the Brontes things are Gothic. So that was no problem. It was fun. It was fun to work out. But it becomes, you get a sense of triumph about it, about each one that you master. And I'm finding that I do six of everything, except right now the book, this is the seventh book.
But your book, this newest book, which you would like to title We Happy Few,
yes,
is an entity of itself.
Yes. Now, the publishers felt that We Happy Few didn't give enough sense of the difficulties that we were facing. So their choice for title, and it will be released under this title, is Refugees from Hollywood, a Journal of the Blacklist Years. And that'll be out in October. And I have to, with a university press, the author has to hustle to sell it. So I'll be, but I loved writing it, because it was a way of capturing. I was afraid, the years had been so interesting in Mexico, just that I didn't want them to be lost. And now as I'm getting old and I'm losing my memory and I know when I die, certain things will vanish if they're not on paper. And I wanted to capture some of the exciting, wonderful, some of the extraordinary experiences that we would never have had if the Blacklist had not touched us and we'd never gone to Mexico. Because those years, because of our relationships with the other Blacklistees, because of the country, which was enormously sweet. But most of our relationships with the other Blacklistees are like trench warfare. World War I vets will say, best years of my life. These were literally the best years of our lives. Except for what the experience did to Hugo, and I think it killed him, basically. He was always a chubby little boy, and his mother loved him to death with pretty good British cooking. But I think that the tensions of our lives through that period increased the blood pressure, the heart trouble, and what he died of was a massive heart attack. But his disintegration, of course, was awful to watch. However, that aside, the living, just the living in Mexico, it was just we lived next door to Diego Rivera's studio, for instance. That was fascinating. The experiences we had in this culture were so rich, and it's such a such a vivid and wonderful culture anyway. It's actually a meld of two cultures, the Indian and the Spanish. And it's and the people we found so sweet and so dear that that all of us blacklistees weep when we hear the mañanitas, when we hear the happy birthday song they sing. We weep. We still do. Because of pure nostalgia.